Have you ever had a big scene you needed to render in Blender and just wish you could just split it up into multiple pieces? Or maybe you even want to swap out a background with a different one? Well, you can in Blender with view layers. As part of this optimization in Blender series, I want to quickly go over view layers and how they can be used to speed up your re-rendering process and give you more flexibility in the compositor. Now, I'm just going to start with the default Blender scene. So I'm just going to adjust this a little bit. And all of the view layer settings is literally in this corner. So it's in the outliner and also this view layer. So this is going to show the collections of view layers that you have. We're going to get to that in a second. But first, let's just focus on the visibility settings for view layers specifically. Now with this filter dropdown, you can add all the different visibility settings in view. So these are all of them. If you've ever wondered what they are, I actually have a full video just on visibility settings. Now for view layers, there are three important ones. There's this checkbox, which is exclude from view layer. Then there's this sphere, which is hold out. And then there's this bouncing ray, which is indirect only. Now let me make my scene a little more interesting by adding another collection. So I'm gonna add a Suzanne. We'll just put that right there. Move into a new collection, we'll call it new collection. I'm gonna be very creative today. And then I'm gonna link duplicate it. So it's just over on this side. And then I'll use cycles. So the main one, of course, is the checkbox. So that is just excluding from the view layer. Now you probably think this is just acts the same as like disable in viewport and disable in render. Let's do a quick example with a separate view layer. So I'm going to add a new one. We'll get into these different ones in a second. But so with this, if I disable in viewport, you'll notice that persists in both view layers. But if I uncheck it in this one and go to the other one, it's still visible here. So the exclude from view layer is a visibility setting specific to that view layer. So this is for hiding them from the view layer, excluding them from the view layer. Now there's these other ones. So let's look at holdout. So if I click holdout, you'll notice it kind of disappears. It becomes more apparent as to its usage. If you go to film, there's a transparent checkbox. It may be formatted a little bit differently in EV, but you'll see it just completely disappears, but it gives a little cutout of itself. So both of the Suzanne heads kind of cut themselves out of the render. So that's what holdout does. It just masks the objects in that collection out of the render. This is more useful with visual effects, like when you're match moving a placeholder CG object that represents something that's actually in the video. You can use this as a way to easily occlude CG objects behind real life objects. So very useful and more of a compositing thing, which I'll get to. You'll notice that despite it cutting out the object, it's still affecting the rest of the scene. So if I make this more apparent, you can see the indirect lighting, but I'll make it more apparent by adding a red color. So you can see the red of the Suzanne is still bouncing off the cube in this case. So it's not just excluding it, it's still using it in the render, just cutting it out of the render. Now, if I turn off that and I do indirect only, it's not cutting itself out, but it's still affecting the rest of the scene. So that's all that indirect only means, is that it's just hiding it from direct view, but still affecting other objects in the scene. And this is also a cycles only feature as of Blender 4.2 at least. So if I switch over to EV,
6.5 hours later.
So you can see the indirect only makes no difference here. So it's just a cycles only setting as of Blender 4.2 at least. And you'll notice this is actually very similar to just going to the object properties for them in the visibility panel. Now, fun tip, if you hold Alt and select or change a property while having multiple selected, it'll change it for all of them. Very useful tip. But this is effectively doing the same thing as indirect only. So it's not showing the object directly, but it's still affecting other objects in the scene. But this is just a nice way of conveniently having it be assigned to the collection instead of just per object, especially since one object can be in multiple collections. Now, let's make an example of using multiple view layers in this case. So I'm going to undo that, and then I'm going to have it where the cube is on one view layer and then the Suzannes are on another. What did I? Oh, I have to add it back. Okay, so have the cube on one, and we'll mask out. We'll do a holdout of the Suzanne's on this one. Then we're going to create a new layer. So there's a few options. There's new, and this basically just does the defaults. So checkboxes, indirect, and holdout off. Then if we do copy settings, and of course copies the view layer related settings. And then lastly is blank, which just does defaults, but it unchecks the boxes. This is useful if you have like hundreds of collections and you only just want one visible for that given view layer. So you can just do blank and then just check the one. In this case, we'll just do new and we're gonna take out the cube. We don't want that. Oh no, the light's gone. But this is a common thing with view layers of that it's good to have the lights in its own collection. So that way they can always be on for all of the objects using them. And then so that way I can have the cube out, but it's not affecting the light. This will do Suzanne's. So we can swap between these two. So now let's render and composite these. So we're gonna go to the compositing tab, and then I'm just gonna make this big, and then check the use nodes so we can have our nodes available to us. Now you'll notice with the render layers, we can actually see our different view layers here. And so that way each node can represent different view layers. So I'm gonna duplicate it and then have this one be Suzanne's. And this little button means you can render that active view layer. So I'm gonna render Suzanne's. I forgot to turn on the samples to 496. Thankfully the noise threshold kicked in. And you can see it composited to nothing because we don't have our cube rendered and the Suzanne's is not connected to the composite. Let's fix that. Render the cube. There we go. And then using Node Wrangler, of course, this is beating a dead horse at this point, I think. So if you haven't heard of Node Wrangler, go to the add-ons tab in your Blender preferences, enable Node Wrangler. But anyway. And so with this, we're gonna composite them together. So all you need is an alpha over. And so this is probably a little confusing if you're used to other compositors, but the top socket is the background layer, background image. And then the bottom one is the foreground. And with that, you can see it blended them perfectly. And you don't even have to worry about pre-multiplication with the renders. You can just leave it as is. But yeah, so that's the basics of it. And in terms of its usefulness, now let's say maybe I want to change the color of the cube. So let me go back to the cube. And let me change it to a blue. And go back to the compositor. Now, instead of me having to render both, I can just render the cube. I'll do that. Look at that, and it also updates the composite as well. So the nice thing with this is, obviously this is a more minimal example, but it allows you to have some flexibility with adjusting and redoing parts of your render without having to re-render everything. Now, obviously with this minimal example, it's not really true to life. Let me give you a real life example. So this is called Moving Meditations. This was actually a render challenge hosted by Clint. He was part of Corridor Digital. So there's three different view layers in this case. First layer is the character in the foreground with some floating icebergs on the water. And then there's the background, and there's landscape and igloos. In this case, let me change it to cycles. I originally rendered it in Eevee, I believe, but with Eevee Next, it's not gonna look the same, so I'll just do cycles. It's a little more consistent to itself. And then you can already see this is over nearly 2 million triangles at this point, so this is a pretty big scene. Then I also have an Aurora view layer, so hopefully this doesn't destroy the recording. Okay. And you can see these are mesh volumes. So these aren't just like little like mesh strips that I did. It's an actual volumetric. So it takes a lot of time, a lot of rendering. You can actually see that it's being cut out. And that is because I'm using the holdout for the view layer. So we have the mountains in front of it, but I don't want the aurora to be sampling the aurora that isn't going to be seen in the file render. So I can just use the holdout and save myself a little bit of time in the render. It's not only am I saving myself having to do one gigantic render and just three more manageable renders, I can also adjust the render settings per render. So I can have one render with the Aurora, which is set at 1024 currently. So it's one render settings for the entire file. Unfortunately, you can't do different render settings per view layer, unfortunately. But then I can have 1024 for the volume samples, and then I can have the background on its own, maybe lower samples, maybe just 512. And then with the foreground, with the character, be something else. And so it allows a lot more flexibility with your renders and allows me to just do the compositing afterward. So as you can see with my compositor, it is very simple. So I just have the Aurora in background with an alpha over, and then the foreground being alpha over, doing the same thing. And then this is just me adding a vignette to it. So, but yeah, that's the benefits of using view layers to optimize your renders. I hope you find this useful. I hope you can utilize view layers in your renders. That way you don't have to re-render everything all over again. And again, this is part of my optimization in Blender series. If you want to check out some of the other videos on it that I've already made, you can watch this playlist or you can subscribe for future optimization in Blender videos. Thank you for watching and happy blending.